Sup, you beautiful bastards. Hope you have a fantastic Tuesday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show, and let's just jump into it. And the first thing we're gonna do today is jump into a little segment I call Today in Stupid. That stupid comes from Deadspin, specifically managing editor Tom Lay, who put out the article, "They Turned Spider-Man Into a Damn Cop, and It Sucks." Which, and keep in mind, just my opinion here, is one of the most idiotic takeaways you could get from the new Spider-Man game. And really early on in this article, you realize that Tom has his head down, just sprinting as fast as possible into the stupid, when he writes, "Granted, I am only a few hours into the game, but so far, the primary objective boils down to help the cops. Not just any cops either, but the NYPD specifically, because the game takes place in a true-to-life rendering of New York City." Writing, "It is also impossible for me at least to not feel some ickiness about the game forcing me into cahoots with even a fictionalized version of the NYPD." Later writing, "He's no longer performing heroic deeds out of just the goodness of his heart, but also for the purpose of solidifying the existing power structure's grip on the city." Again, this is how the first few hours of the game works. And maybe there is a forthcoming plot twist in which Spider-Man realizes that he no longer wants to be an agent of the state. And he closes the article by saying, "All I know is that it kind of sucks to play a game in which Spider-Man, in the process of beating up some drug dealers, haunts them by yelling, 'If you just got real jobs, you wouldn't have to work so hard at being criminals.'" And there are a few takeaways here. One, very bold move of Tom to randomly take a swing at the NYPD and explain his disgust on 9/10. But I don't want to make this about you having or not having any class whatsoever. Instead, what I would like to make this about is shining a light on a managing editor for a highly trafficked website writing an article about a thing he has not even fully consumed. About a thing that if he did actually consume as much as he said he did, he still had a bad take. Without jumping into spoilers later on, in the beginning, what you're talking about, Spider-Man works with one specific cop, not the NYPD in general. A cop who has to keep secret that she works with Spider-Man. And if you paid attention to dialogue in certain scenes, rather than trying to just pick and choose things that fit the narrative that you wanted to put out there, you would realize that Spider-Man constantly says things like, "I need to get out of here before the police get here." And once again, still police officers in a video game who are trying to crack down on the bad guys. And to Tom Lay, who has made light of this situation on Twitter, writing, "I would like to sincerely apologize for writing about the video game." Tom, managing editor at Deadspin, it's not that you wrote about a video game, it's that you wrote a stupid, clickbaity, hate cops article about a thing you didn't even fucking really play. And that's really it. And the tweet in general just comes off dismissive, like, "Oh, those video game kids, they're all angry, sorry about writing about the video game." When even in your article, it appears that you are aware of how ridiculous your take is, that you have to write, quote, "I'm not grasping for as many straws as it may appear." You do so transparently and so sloppily that the only way you could have done it more is if you literally grasped at these straws, which if you need them, go for it. Side note, actual straws are not what that is supposed to be referencing, but I could rant for a few more minutes about the why certain parts of this are so annoying, and I think that it's actually to the detriment of a much larger space than just Deadspin. But this has already taken up too much time, and I do want to pass a question off to you. Do you personally feel this is representative of what we have seen and what we are seeing more and more online? People seemingly making stories to kind of stir up shit, and the actual facts, deep dive, in this case, completion of a thing that you're going to comment on, that comes second? Or do you think that these are more outlier situations? Or, hey, third option, this is the Philip DeFranco Show, you don't always have to agree with me. That's not the intent here. Do you agree with them? Any and all thoughts? Let me know down below. And then let's talk about Hurricane Florence. If you are on the East Coast, specifically around the Carolinas region, please listen to your local government and law enforcement about evacuations. Right now, it's being reported that Hurricane Florence is about 2 days away from making landfall. And right now, it appears that Florence is going to be a special kind of horrible. Now, keep in mind, it is possible that the hurricane will slow down. It's possible that it could turn away. It won't hit the coast. But if Hurricane Florence does make landfall in North Carolina or Virginia, as it is currently predicted, according to meteorologist Bob Henson, it would be the first Category 4 hurricane to ever hit that far north ever, as far as recorded history. It would be unprecedented, and you're talking about it hitting an area that is susceptible to storm surge flooding. And that's actually one of the main points with Florence, because it's not just about the winds being fast and powerful, it's about the water. Reportedly, Florence is carrying a huge amount of water vapor, and it's being predicted that once Florence makes landfall, that it will move slowly, so the people being hit will be hit for an extended period of time. And keep in mind, I would be incredibly happy if it turns out this is a lot of fuss for something that does not come to fruition. But we are talking about a situation where the Weather Service Service is warning people in North and South Carolina to expect dangerous to catastrophic storm surge impacts, the likes of which would make coastal areas uninhabitable for extended periods of time. And once again, this is on top of those winds. Winds that the Weather Service in the landfall areas are calling life-threatening, and the likes of which that could cause the complete destruction of sturdy buildings. I mean, it's the reason why more than a million people have been ordered to evacuate. In fact, Maryland, both the Carolinas, Virginia, and DC have declared states of emergency, opening up access to federal funds, and the National Guard is being mobilized in several states as well. But the main thing here, the main point here, is if you are in the affected areas, please, please, please take this serious. But from that, I want to share some stuff I love today, and today in Awesome, brought to you by BetterHelp.com/DeFranco. And BetterHelp, if you don't know, is the fantastic place, service, and app where you can get affordable private online counseling. Right on your computer, your tablet, your phone, you get access to licensed, trained, experienced, accredited psychologists. And all you've got to do to get started is just go to BetterHelp.com/DeFranco. You fill out a questionnaire, they match you with a counselor, and you can start counseling today. And I always mention this when talking about BetterHelp, and I think it's incredibly important given the kind of service it is, but they are not just a sponsor, but it is a service I personally use and recommend. And that's because whether it be myself or you, I think it's smart to be proactive when it comes to mental health. And it's nice to just have this in my pocket. There's no long drive, traffic, waiting rooms, headaches. But main point, if this sounds interesting to you, you want to check it out, you want to try it out, just go to BetterHelp.com/DeFranco. And the first bit of awesome today is a recommendation, if you could not tell from that first story. Spider-Man is fantastic. If you have a PS4, it is a must-have, in my opinion. I don't even care if you like or dislike Spider-Man. It is just a good, solid game. They even made just getting from one point to another so incredibly fun and visually appealing. And rather than the side stories and challenges feeling like things you have to check off, or you're like, oh, I gotta get that platinum trophy, it feels like the world is more alive because of them. But that's my personal takeaway. Obviously, art is subjective. You all have different tastes, but that's my say. Then we got the honest trailer for Predator. We had Jeff Goldblum breaking down some of his fashion looks. We got both a trailer for and 27 minutes of gameplay of Assassin's Creed Odyssey. We had Dude Perfect, well, just being Dude Perfect. And if you want to see the full versions of everything I just shared, the secret link of the day, really anything at all, links, as always, are in the description down below. And then let's talk about the situation around Serena Williams, Naomi Osaka, which I thought was really coming to an end, but has just continued to blow up. And in case you didn't see it over the weekend, on Saturday, Serena Williams was facing Naomi Osaka in the US Open Finals. And if she won, this would have been Williams's 24th Grand Slam victory. However, she ended up having a one-sided defeat against the 20-year-old Osaka, which was historic in its own right. But the main point of conversation around this moment was the massive controversy around it. So what happened? Well, during her match with Osaka, Williams receives a code violation warning for coaching. This is because during Grand Slams, coaches aren't allowed to communicate with players in any way, and umpire Carlos Ramos saw Williams's coach giving out hand signals and called out Williams for it. She then responded by saying this:
I don't cheat to win, I'd rather lose.
Then, after losing some more points to Osaka, Williams then slams her racket into the ground in frustration, leading to another violation and thus a point penalty. She then proceeded to yell at the umpire.
Every time I play here, I didn't get coaching. You need to make an announcement that I didn't get coaching. I don't cheat, I didn't get coaching. How can you say that? You owe me an apology. I have never cheated in my life. I have a daughter and I stand what's right for her, and I've never cheated. And you owe me an apology. For you to attack my character is something that's wrong. You owe me an apology. You will never, ever, ever be on another court of mine as long as you live. You are the liar. You owe me an apology. Say it. Say you're sorry. How dare you insinuate that I was cheating?
And in response to this, Ramos gives Williams a game penalty for verbal abuse. Williams demands to see referee Brian Early in response and can be heard saying,
"To lose a game for whoever's saying that is not fair. There are men out here that do lot worse, but because I'm a woman, you're gonna take this away from me?
And in the post-match press conference, she also said, I've seen other men call umpires several things. For me to say thief and for him to take a game, it made me feel like it was a sexist remark. On top of all of this, Williams was also fined $17,000 for her actions. Following all of this, we saw some high-profile people in the tennis community coming out in support of Williams. On Sunday, you had Katrina Adams, president of the United States Tennis Association, saying, I would say last night is unfortunate. We have to have consistency, because when you look at what the women, in this case Serena, is feeling, we watch the guys do this all the time. They are badgering the chair umpires on the changeover. Nothing happens. Adding, a line could have been drawn, but when you look at Carlos in this situation, it's a judgment call to give that last penalty because she called him a thief. They've been called a lot more. He could have said, hey, we're getting out of hand here, let's tone it down. I think he would have said that to a male player. We also had Steve Simon, chief executive of the Women's Tennis Association, agreeing, saying the WTA believes there should be no difference in the standards of tolerance provided to the emotions expressed by men versus women, and is committed to working with the sport to ensure that all players are treated the same. We do not believe that this was done last night. You also had male players chiming in, Andy Roddick tweeting, worst refereeing
I've ever seen the worst.
You also had James Blake tweeting, I will admit I have said worse and not gotten penalized.
And I've also been given a soft warning by the ump where they tell you knock it off or I will give you a violation.
He should have at least given her that courtesy. Sad Damar, a well played final that way.
Now there are a few things to talk about in this initial situation.
You have the umpire in this match, Carlos Ramos, and also the idea that in general there's likely a big difference in how women and men are treated in the sport.
Central to this incident, you have Ramos, who is being portrayed as a sexist because of how he chose to enforce the rules.
Especially with the rule that set Williams off, coaching, which Williams said that she was never coached and doesn't use it.
But on that note, her coach did admit in a post-match interview that he was trying to coach her, but expressed his view that everyone does it, including Osaka's coach during the match, saying, I am honest, I was coaching. But then adding, I don't think she looked one time. Sasha was coaching every point too.
And so this has led to the conversation that the rule is selectively being enforced here, and when it is enforced, it's the player who incurs the penalty, not the coach.
Also, overall, with Ramos, he's known as a stickler for the rules and is also considered one of the best umpires in the sport.
He's overseen 4 Grand Slam finals and the Olympic gold medals.
But at the same time, you had people going out and finding examples of men and other women saying and doing things that were far worse on court to Ramos with no point or game violations.
But also, this has brought up a debate about specific words and actions.
Some saying it's more offensive, more of an attack to call an official a liar, a thief, than just cursing.
We also saw the ITF put out a statement yesterday defending Ramos,
writing, Carlos Ramos is one of the most experienced and respected umpires in tennis.
Mr. Ramos's decisions were in accordance with the relevant rules and were reaffirmed by the US Open's decision to fine Serena Williams for the 3 offenses.
But then also adding, it is understandable that this high profile and regrettable incident should provoke debate.
Now all of that said, it's important to note that this situation and controversy does not exist in a bubble.
While this moment with Serena may not be the clearest example of sexism, we saw another incident at the US Open.
And that was a situation around Elise Cornette, who left her match at the US Open for a 10-minute heat break,
and when she came back, she realized her shirt was on backwards, so on the court, she changed that shirt and was given a violation for taking that shirt off.
The umpire even saying, this is not okay.
And following this, there was a lot of outrage, people saying that this was sexist, especially when you compare this to male players who regularly take their shirts off on the court without any issue.
One example from the US Open is Novak Djokovic, who sat shirtless on the sideline while his opponent was excused to change his shirt.
In fact, the US Open Twitter account even tweeted a photo of him with the caption, summertime and the living is easy.
And in fact, after all the backlash for the penalty against Cornette, the US Open went back and said that the call was a mistake.
So there was all of that happened, things started settling down, and then something happened yesterday that just blew it all back up.
The Herald Sun, which is an Australian tabloid, published a cartoon by cartoonist Mark Knight depicting Serena Williams jumping on a racket with the ump saying to Osaka, can you just let her win?
And many called out this image as racist for a few different reasons.
And mainly it's the depiction of Serena with exaggerated features, but also some are criticizing the apparent whitewashing of Osaka.
You had J.K. Rowling commenting on the cartoon saying,
well done on reducing one of the greatest sportswomen alive to racist and sexist tropes and turning a second great sportswoman into a faceless prop.
You also had the National Association of Black Journalists in the U.S. denouncing the cartoon saying,
it not only exudes racist, sexist caricatures of both women, but Williams's depiction is unnecessarily Sambo-like.
However, Knight said that the cartoon about Serena was about her poor behavior on the day, not about race.
You also had the newspaper's editor, Damon Johnston, saying, a champion tennis player had a mega tantrum on the world stage, and Mark's cartoon depicted that, adding it had nothing to do with gender or race.
However, you had many people saying, well, if you just look at the image, that appears like a lie, or at the very least, the intent does not seem to matter.
But on the other side, you had people saying that people overreacting about this comment.
And as far as any other statements or notes from Knight, we don't have those because as of right now, he has deactivated his Twitter account.
And so ultimately with this situation, where do I land thus far?
As far as sexism existing in the sport, I feel like the clothing situation is the better example here.
Right? I feel like that moment was pretty blatant.
Also around the idea that Serena Williams was targeted because she's a woman or she's black, I don't know if that's what I really see there. I think it's more likely that she was targeted because she's Serena Williams.
And I'm not saying that if that is actually what happened, that is the reason that that is fair. But I think it's important to point that out because I think where we saw a lot of sexism, where we saw a lot of racism, was in the reaction.
How in the covering of this story, people talked about her being hysterical, throwing a tantrum.
You know, when you have certain places saying that Serena Williams was being hysterical, but with a man, they would say fiery passion.
If you look back to people in the past in the same sport, you had people like John McEnroe, the bad boy of tennis.
And so I think there would be more of a debate to be had there. And as far as that cartoon,
I know that a lot of cartoonists do kind of exaggerated features, but it's hard for me to look at that photo and not think that's somewhat racist.
And here's the thing, none of us are inside of Mark Knight's head, so we don't know if the intent is there, but the picture that he has for Serena Williams is Sambo-like in my opinion, and I don't know why in his version Osaka appears to be a white blonde woman.
Because once again, if you don't remember, this is what she looks like.
And so I don't know if he drew Osaka like that because he was ignorant to the situation, he didn't actually know who she was, the main focus was Serena Williams and he didn't really care about anything else, or it was supposed to be a little bit of a dog whistle.
But that said, there is the story, then my personal takeaway and my kind of feelings on it, and I pass the question off to you. What are your thoughts about any and all things with this one? And then let's talk about the really concerning news around Dr. Disrespect. Now, if you're not familiar with him, he's a massive streamer. I would have loved if this story was he just had a really awesome big stream yesterday. He was streaming the new Blackout beta to a ton of people. But today, something horrifying happened. Someone appears to have fired a gun at his house. And according to his comments after, this isn't the only time this has happened.
Ladies and gentlemen, I gotta fucking end, I've gotta end the broadcast right now. Someone shot at our house, broke the fucking upstairs window. This is the second shot someone shot yesterday at our, someone shot yesterday at our fucking house. And someone shot again right now and connected with the house. Upstairs.
And as of right now, all we know, and it is good news, no one was hurt. It appears he's changed the title of his stream to Doc and Family Are Safe. Proper measures are being taken while stream is down for the day. And while it is possible that this is something that's not connected to him being a streamer, it's hard not to think that that is the reason. I mean, streamers are already having to deal with stalkers that find their house and they wait outside or they try to get in, or the threat of swatting to the point where most prominent streamers have to know their local police department to let them know, hey, just so you know, someone might call you and say some crazy stuff's going down at my house in hopes that something crazy happens on stream or that you shoot me. And now someone's shooting into this guy's house where his baby and his wife live while he's streaming. And I don't know how to end this story because I want there to be some takeaway or some advice, but it's just scary. It's just scary. Obviously, I wish him and his family safety and the best, and I can't imagine what they're having to go through right now. No one should have to deal with this because they just want to entertain people online. That all of a sudden they now have to deal with some crazy person who's going to shoot a gun into a house for recognition on a live stream. I'm at a loss for words. The world's just a ridiculous and scary place at times. And so the note I'll end on, best wishes to Doc and his family. And I really hope the scumbag or scumbags doing this to you get theirs. And that's where we're going to end today's show. But also remember, I want these videos to be a conversation. So whether it be the last story, the first one, anything in between, let me know what you're thinking in those comments down below. And also while you're at it, if you like this video, you like my dumb face, hit that like button. If you're new here, hit that subscribe button. But with that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces and I'll see you tomorrow.